stand to our feet in reverence to the word and turn to the gospel of St. Matthew. We're going to go to the second chapter. We are going to start at, we're going to start at verse 14. When you get it, say, still say. Gospel of Matthew chapter 2. We're going to start at verse 14. When you get it, say, still say. Amen. All right, I'm going to read and you will follow. And verse 14 says, so he got up, took the child and his mother during the night and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod, and was so fulfilled, and so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, out of Egypt I call my son. When Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious. And he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. Then what was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and refusing to be comforted because they are no more. After Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel. For those who were trying to take the child's life are dead. So he got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning in Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Having been warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee. And he went and lived in a town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled what was said through the prophets, that he would be called a Nazarene. Lord, add a blessing to the hearing and to the reading of this most holy, holy word. Amen. Let me start off by saying that I am trying to bless you who have come all this way in this snow. Amen? Amen. So we have a word for you, and we pray it will bless you. But I will be within your timeliness. Amen? Whatever that may be. Amen? But now some of you, in your timeliness, I will be done preaching already. I can't give you that one. Amen? Hear me on this, church. Our sermonic theme is, you can go home now.
Amen.
You can go home now, amen. Spiritually. Look, Herod stands as one of the more intense, evil figures of his day. He was a clear abuse of power that was epitomized by his insecurity. He was afraid to let go and let a new king come, and would do everything he could to ensure he would be king. So any threat to his power. He responded violently to kill the threat. That was his insecurity. Now, God had always made a fool of earthly kings and earthly power structures simply because we become too focused on man than on God. We value humanity and what they think of us more than how we value God and what God feels about us. We may look good to humanity, but we're a mess to God. Humanity have a different set of values, earthly values. We look good with degrees and money and things such as that, and feel as though from our view, we say they made it. But yet on the inside of the gate, there is inherent turmoil and distress, because even though they have achieved earthly good, they're still messed up on the inside. That's Herod. He had riches, he had power, but yet he's still worried about this king that's supposed to come. And so he's going to do whatever he can do to kill this king. So Herod can represent our insecurity that those of us who are humans may have. He also represents a desire to steal the joy that we have in Jesus. He wants to, this joy of this new king, he wants to destroy and put down so that people look at him. We see it through biblical history, Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. He wanted to destroy any revolt by making them bow down to him. Even if we go further back and we see the Tower of Babel, they wanted to be like God, but God took them down by giving them different languages so they couldn't communicate. Their human arrogance got them in trouble. All right. Now, when we hear then that Herod is dead, what God has done is God has killed the fear. Right. Now, God had this family escape and go to a safe place. That's what God will do with us. Okay? Because there are some battles that we're trying to fight that we can't win. Because we try to do it on our own. Talk to me, somebody. So sometimes God got to take you out of a situation in order that he can have it. The problem is we keep putting ourselves back in there to help God, and God don't need our help. Talk to me, somebody. Look, God know what it's going to take, okay, to ensure the safety of his child. So again, we got to be put at times in a safe house. And I'm going to say this, church, sometimes your safe house, it just may be uncomfortable. Because you're like, I got to do something.
Yeah, I got
to help out in some way. It's not happening as soon as I need it to happen. It's not going as fast as I need it to go. I'm not seeing what I need to see. Because humanity needs some physical results in order to feel satisfied.
Yes.
Talk to me, somebody. Yeah. Right. And that's where we mess up. Look. God puts a fence around his children to protect us from the mess that's going on. You ever be on your job, say, and you see all this chaos going on, but yet you got a peace amongst you where you ain't worried because you know God got it? That's that spirit.
spiritual fence that goes around you. Yeah. And sometimes you got to go to Egypt to let God handle this. What do it look like Joseph up in there trying to fight Herod? He's got to be able to clean it up. Now, we always have to realize this. God's specialty is turning enemies into footstools.
All right, look at that.
That's his specialty, church. He finds the great human structure and destroys it and put it under his feet. And now that his son has arrived, God is not playing at all. This is no joke. This is his boy. It's going to intensify even more. So Herod don't have to pay a price with his death. It is when Herod dies, he said, come on, you can come on back now. Why? He fought the battle for you. Look, it is no secret throughout this scripture. The prophetic nature of this word is coming out. To the point that even when Joseph tries to adjust it in the last verses there, verse 22, when he heard that Archelaus was reigning in Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Having been warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee. He went and lived in a town called Nazareth. And by going to Nazareth, he fulfilled the prophecy.
Yes. Yes.
We've been talking in these past few weeks. There were many adjustments that had to occur to get Jesus here. There were things that had to be moved around in order that joy could get here. The same as it is with your life. In order for you to feel the joy, you're going to have to adjust some things. There's people that's going to have to go, church. And you need to get in for 2017 now. And you're going to have to take this seriously. Because there is an evil that is intensifying from government on that. And in order for your spirit to be preserved, there's you going to have to protect it like you never had to protect it before. Because for media, social media, news, all these things are attacking. And if you only focus on what this humanity tool is saying, then you won't believe in yourself and you won't believe in God no more. The economy can be bad, but you'll be good. Because God got you on this. Violence and everything is going on. Jesus and them living in peace. Because God is fighting and taking over the battle. Don't mess this up, church, by trying to do it yourself. Let God do this. Why do it say, trust in the Lord with all thy heart? Lean not to thy own understanding. In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he'll do what? He'll guide your path. Christ returning to Nazareth is only the completion of the plan that God has set him forth in the first place.
Amen.
The angel had coordinated all of these entities in order that Jesus can live and ultimately die for our sins. He set it up. But they had to listen in order that joy could arrive. Look, hear me on this. Look, we were on an airplane and we were leaving out. The weather was not great. Okay? So they held us on the runway for a long time. And we couldn't figure out why they held us on the runway. And the pilot came on and said they had to clean off the runway just so we could fly.
Yeah.
We were in a holding pattern, in a small plane, in tight condition, not the most comfortable. But we were held there in order that that runway could be clear.
Yes, sir.
So we could take off. It may be uncomfortable at times. It may be tough at times. But understand, God is still working a plan.
Yes.
If he worked this to get his son here, what won't he do for the children of his son?
Yes.
Come on, we praise God for his holy word.
Yes.
And that's all I have. Amen.
Amen.